Okay, good morning everyone again. I'd like first to thank Piet and Patrick for this wonderful occasion to be again in Basel. For really every year we get a better and better meetings, and I wonder what is the limit, Piet? So I'm looking forward to see the limit. Okay, the sky is the limit. Okay, so today I'm really very, very happy and very honored to have with us Professor Aaron Chechanover from the Medical School of the Technion in Haifa. Aaron and me share a little bit of a common past at the place that I did my PhD in the Hebrew University of Jerusalem in the medical school. Aaron did his master degree. And actually, we shared a bench together. You know, at that time, students had very little space, and we shared the bench together. It seems I was not infected by the Nobel, so I think I'm clean of this, unfortunately. But Aaron really is a fantastic scientist, and to me, the Nobel he received, being a biochemist, I think is one of the most important Nobels from the first line of Nobels, because he dealt with something that was very, very unexpected. When I was a biochemist student about 50 years ago when I started, you know, people just were starting to understand protein biosynthesis. And actually everything took for granted that the proteolysis or the degradation of the protein is a very simple process of simple proteases. And we all knew about the lysosomes, and this was the pathway that everyone accepted as how the cell get rid of the proteins. Now when Aaron and Avraham Hershko and came with their work about the ubiquitin, I think it was very difficult for people to accept it, even for leaders in the field like the Div and others that really did not like the idea that there is energy-dependent process, not only of the synthesis, but also of the degradation, and also that the cell has the ability to kind of identify protein it wants to get rid of. I'm not going to tell you more about it because Aaron will do it much better than I do, but Aaron got all the important prizes that we can think about. I mean, going from the Lasker Prize, then the Israel Prize for his work, and finally the Nobel Prize. He's also a member of almost any Academy of Science you can think on, from the Israel, Russia, US, China, and many others. Also, he got many, many doctorate of honors from many universities all over the world. And I think he probably spent big part of his time going from one place and the other and educate people. But he's also a very unique person, very highly appreciated in Israel for his contribution to education. He always say what he think, and you will hear it probably here. And I think I'm really very, very happy to have him with us. Aaron, please. Share with us the new things about the ubiquitin system.
Good morning. Thank you very much, Chezi, for the introduction. So what I shall try to do in the short time is take you through a marathon of how at all we discovered it, why people come to the lab and think that there is still most of the iceberg is still underneath the water. And then I'll tell you how the system was applied recently to drug development, and we are just at the very beginning. So we are here in the city of Haifa, which is the very east side of the Mediterranean. It's a beautiful city on the rolling mountain, the Carmel Mountain, and the medical school is here. So just a wonderful point. This is the mountain. The city is scattered on the mountain on the Bay of Haifa. And as Chezi mentioned, many people in between the 50s and I would say the early 80s were busy with the secret of protein synthesis, the genetic code, the central dogma of biology, how information flows from in the simple model from DNA to RNA to proteins, and very few people dealt with the destruction because they were already prejudiced. Not only the destruction is non-specific, but people looked at the gastrointestinal tract and they saw that all the proteins that go in are degraded with no exception to amino acids by a collection of proteases and then other systems. So people said, what can be so interesting about it? But if we look at the map of destruction today, it looks awfully complex. So from destruction of the whole cell, from apoptosis, that is activated by numerous signals and is highly selective, especially the sensing mechanism, so the DNA damage, oxidative damage, any damage that elicits all developmental sensing, you know, sensing of developmental signals that have to eliminate, for example, the interdigital tissue in order to generate the fingers. So the apoptotic pathway is extremely complicated. The lysosome that I'm going to talk about that was discovered by Christian de Dive initially was thought to be a very simple organelle that, you know, proteases that are secluded within a membrane, and then proteins are brought into it either from the outside of the cell by receptor-mediated endocytosis, phagocytosis, pinocytosis, endocytosis, and then by microautophagy from within the cell. And now we know that autophagy comes back to the surface, and there are several types of autophagy, and it's an awfully complicated process involved in numerous diseases and also in eliminating faulty organelles like mitochondria. And we know, for example, that failure to remove faulty mitochondria results, for example, in Parkinson's disease. So autophagy, with all its complexity, is part of the destructive process, and the lysosome is in the middle. And then the ubiquitin system that I'm going to talk about, but they all talk to one another. So actually, it's a well-integrated map, and elements of the ubiquitin system are scattered all over the place, and I'm going to allude on it as time permits. So we know that destruction occurs in the body in several locations, and as we climbed up, the layer of specificity increases. So in the gastrointestinal tract, we are eliminating proteins in order to derive energy, but also to remove antigenicity. Then we are moving the gastrointestinal tract is outside the body topologically, so it's extracorporeal. Then we are moving into the body, but outside of the cells. So for example, in the circulation, but outside the cells, we find the coagulation system that is a bona fide cascade of proteolytic event in which one activates the other, and at the very end, fibrinogen is converted to fibrin to generate the blood clot. We were not interested in either of those. We are interested in what's going on in the cell, in how the cell eliminates its own proteins. But there is something in common to all these systems, and I'm going to highlight it because I don't want you to remember details. I'm not going to load you with details anyway. I want you to remember the principles. Proteolysis is destructive, however we look into it, and it doesn't matter where it occurs because we always introduce chemically a molecule of water and split a peptide bond into two. So it doesn't matter where it occurs. So proteolysis is destructive. So always, always, the body has to protect itself against proteolysis. And at each level, different mechanisms have evolved. So in the gastrointestinal tract, how we protect ourselves? By the mucinous secretion that protects the gastrointestinal epithelium. And if the mucinous secretion, the continuity is disrupted, there is a disease, ulcer, for example. In the blood coagulation system, how we protect ourselves from untoward coagulation in the coronary artery. We just heard about one of the most common diseases in the Western world, myocardial infarction, and the atherosclerotic process that precedes it. We protect ourselves by localization. So if we get wounded, we are secreting tissue factors, and we recruit coagulation factor into the site. Once it occurs in the coronary artery due to inflammatory process or to accumulation of cholesterol in the atheromatotic inflammatory process, then, you know, it's untoward effect. We don't want it to occur there. And in the cell, the old vision about the lysosome was very simple. The proteases are inside the organelle. They are surrounded by a membrane, and the load, the cargo, has to get into the lysosome, typically by vesicle fusion. Let it be endosomes, early endosome, late endosome, and so on and so forth, starting at the cell surface by clathrin-coated pits and then going into. But the proteases themselves are never exposed to the cellular environment, to the cytosol. So remember the principle of protection. And in any system that you are looking into, this mechanism has to be preserved. When we are talking about apoptosis, obviously it's occurring only in the cell, in one single cell, not in the neighboring cell, and by signaling. So we make sure that everything is contained. So why at all we are degrading proteins? Why not to, you know, in the cell? So now we are limiting the discussion to intracellular proteolysis. And why at all to degrade protein? Why not to carry them forever until we are dying, according to Patrick, at the age of 90 or 100, according to the Jewish faith at the age of 120, but the difference is not so much. So quality control is a major issue, misfolding, mutation, oxidation, all kinds of post-translational modification. When we are accumulating harmful misfolded proteins, we are ending up with disease. Actually, all neurodegenerative diseases, the hallmark of those diseases are accumulation of misfolded proteins or abnormal proteins. Then we need to remove proteins in order to control processes. In that case, we are removing healthy functional proteins like cell cycle regulation. We have to remove inhibitors along the cell cycle in order to allow the cell to progress from one stage to another, or removal of transcription factor like P53, NF-kappa-B, June, FOS, that we don't need anymore. So these are healthy proteins. It's not quality control, but it's regulation of processes. And needless to say, in order to maintain the differentiated and morphogenetic state of tissues, we need to remove in the embryonic stage, as the embryo develops, proteins that are not needed anymore in certain tissues, and they do come back in different... there is a dead differentiation process in malignancies. In many malignancies, the ultimate tumor that I still remember as a medical student is obviously teratoma, in which we see teeth and muscles and bones that are coming back. So as you see, there are many reasons why we cannot remain static, and we have to remove our proteins. And just to give you an unbelievable number, that we are removing daily about 6 to 8% of our proteins, 6 to 8%, which is an amazing number. The proteins obviously vary in their half-lifetime. Some are living only a few minutes, transcription factor. Some are living many days, like hemoglobin, 120 days. But on the average, 6 to 8% of all our proteins are removed daily and are renewed daily. So we are synthesizing and destroying daily 8% of our proteins, which raises numerous questions. One question is, people laugh at it, it looks like philosophical, but it's actually a very deep biological question. If I am not today what I was 3 months ago, as far as my proteome is concerned, then who am I anyway? Think about it, think about computers. If you have to throw your computer and buy an identical one, you need to move the software from one to another. We don't have to do it. We maintain and even improve the software, the high functions of the brain, and so on, despite the fact that the hardware is being replaced all the time. It's not a simple biological question. People think of imprinting, the prion model of Stanley Prusiner, and so on and so forth, but I don't want to go into it. And then, obviously, what are the mechanisms that carry it out? And then what happens if the mechanisms go wrong, and then what can we do about it? So I'll try to really devote 5-7 minutes to each of those questions very quickly. The founding father of the field, in many ways, if you can really pinpoint to a beginning, in biology it's very difficult to pinpoint to a beginning, is Rudolf Schenheimer, a Jewish scientist that worked in Germany. Nazis came to power, all the Jews were fired, and went out, mostly to the United States, some to the UK, among them Albert Einstein, and it became a term. It calls Hitler's gift. This is the gift that Hitler gave to the West. And actually, this movement established or initiated the conversion of American science from, I would say, from phenomenological to mechanistic, what we used to know as the American science that is now, unfortunately, in many ways on the decline. Here it focused more on biology. Again, Hitler's gift by Eugene Kennedy from Harvard Medical School. And many scientists belong to this era, from Fritz Lippmann, probably the father of modern biochemistry, coenzyme A, and many other important discoveries, Rudolf Schenheimer, Konrad Bloch, cholesterol. We talked about cholesterol, the biosynthetic pathway of cholesterol, and the statins that came later on. So it's major figures along the way. And Rudolf Schoenheimer described a simple phenomenon. He took rats, fed them with labeled amino acids, actually N15, heavy isotope labeled amino acids, and found that they go into proteins and then come out. So proteins are dynamic. This was in the late 30s, early 40s. And in his obituary, he committed suicide. It was a very interesting story. In the New York Times, it says that his work helped establish that the living body is a chemical laboratory of varied and complex transformation of matter are taking place incessantly. So we are dynamic, not only in proteins, but also in lipids and carbohydrates, and so on and so forth. Then the field moved, and people discovered that proteins are degraded, and they are degraded in a very peculiar way that requires metabolic energy. So here is protein degradation that's taken from the work of Simpson at the early 50s. And you see that once you trap the energy in the incubator from oxygen to nitrogen, protein degradation ceases altogether. With thermodynamically, it didn't make any sense because we are deriving energy from proteins, like we are deriving it from carbohydrates and lipids. So why to invest energy in order to degrade them? Well, this is intracellular protein degradation. This is not in the gastrointestinal tract. And there again, remember the fact that we have to protect ourselves, it's control. In order to control the process, the body has to invest energy. Think about driving a car downhill. There are two ways to do it. Either you, if you don't want to waste gas, fine. Turn the switch off, take your brake, your leg off the brake and drive. But that won't last long. If you want to control the car, you need both to put your leg on the brake and to shift it to a low gear and to keep the engine on. And you are burning energy during downhill run, again, for control. So this is not the exact analogy, but nevertheless, nature always pays with energy in order to control processes. So here is Christian de Dive, the wonderful, charming Belgian-American scientist that discovered the lysosome. And the lysosome was an organelle that was energy dependent because it has a pump, and the pump pumps hydrogen ions into the lysosome in order to maintain the lysosomal pH about 2 logs below the cytosolic one, so you need energy. This is a protective mechanism in case that the lysosome blows off. Because the volume is very small, the pH is diluted out, and the intralysosomal proteases are shut down. It's another protective mechanism because the intralysosomal proteases act only at low pH. So they at neutral pH, they are inactive. So this was an evolutionary protective mechanism. And the lysosome is the organelle that degrades proteins. How? By 2 major mechanisms. From the outside, as I mentioned, via a series of vesicles that are being closed and transported to the lysosome, fuse and deliver their contents, receptor-mediated endocytosis, pinocytosis, all the mechanisms that I mentioned, and then intracellular proteins as well. Christian de Dive thought that the lysosome is the overall organelle by microautophagy, pinching off of droplets of cytosol and converting them into vacuoles, and the vacuoles then pouring their contents into the lysosome. So the world became silent. Here you have proteins are degraded. Here is the mechanism, energy dependence. And for 20 years, everybody was busy with the central dogma. I became a graduate student with Avram Hershko in the late 70s. And then at that time, several people raised doubts whether the lysosome is indeed the organelle that degrades proteins. Most of the doubts came from specificity, because this mechanism cannot be specific because it pinches off droplets of cytosol that contain representative of all cellular proteins. And then people discovered the cell cycle, that cyclins are degraded only during mitosis, and they are stable all along the cell, that only abnormal proteins are degraded, so how the cell can distinguish between abnormal and normal, and so on and so forth. That during starvation, protein degradation goes up, and so there were all kinds of questions. And then when people started to compile data, they found that different proteins indeed have different half-life times, from few minutes to numerous many hours. So how can it be that by taking a droplet of cytosol into the lysosome, different proteins can maintain different half-lifetimes. And how does the cell know that it has to divide and degrade only cyclins out of 25,000 different proteins? So people started to raise questions, not too many people, the competition was not awful. But one critical experiment was carried out by Brian Poole at the Rockefeller University, and he did a simple experiment. I will not go into the details, but he took dish of two dishes of cells. One was labeled with a tritiated isotope, and the other one was tritiated with C14 labeled isotope, amino acid, I mean, tritiated amino acid and C14 labeled amino acid. The one that was treated with C14 amino acid, he took the cells and broke them down, so he homogenized them and overlaid them over the intact cells that were labeled with treated leucine. So here you have, the cell now is given an opportunity to degrade two types of proteins. One type of proteins is the cell's own proteins, the treated metabolically labeled proteins, and then the C14 labeled proteins that were overlaid, which are exogenous proteins. So the cell have to pinocytose them, drink them from the outside environment. He added to the cells chloroquine, which dissipates the intralysosomal pH, so he shuts down the lysosome, and he asks himself, is the lysosome involved in the degradation of intracellular proteins, extracellular proteins, either, both, neither, whatever? And he found the following. He found that the lysosome is involved mostly in the degradation of extracellular proteins. You see, exogenous proteins. The cells, the protein that came from the debris. 68% inhibition by chloroquine. While the degradation of endogenous proteins was only mildly affected. And he summed it up without going into all the summary. He said the exogenous proteins will be broken down in the lysosome, the extracellular proteins. Why? Because I can control them by shutting down the lysosome. While the endogenous proteins will be broken down wherever it is that endogenous proteins are broken down. Somewhere. Go and find it, wherever it is. He was very poetic. He knew about it. He was, in my opinion, the first to predict a non-lysosomal proteolytic system. He died, unfortunately. I came to know him. I was a graduate student. I visited him in his lab in the Rockefeller University in the late 70s. But he died, and Avram decided independently to work on the project, and he started, and together we launched a search after this elusive non-lysosomal system. So you see how you come to the conclusion that there is something that is missing behind, though we had no clue what it is, how big it is, what it means, and anything. So at that time, there was no molecular biology at all. Everything was pure biochemistry. So you need to look for nature to provide you with a system. You cannot silence, you cannot eliminate, you cannot do anything. So we went to reticulocytes. It's a young red blood cell that doesn't have a lysosome already. During the maturation to the mature red blood cell, it ejects the lysosome out. But nevertheless, it is involved heavily in proteolysis of its own machineries to leave behind only residual systems like hemoglobin, you know, the oxygen binding protein, the glycolytic machinery, glutathione in order to keep the ability to reduce potentials and so on and so forth. So the red blood cell is kind of a very primitive cell, and it is generated from a regular cell, so on the way it eliminates all the system. So we said, wow, we have here an ideal system. No lysosome, nevertheless degradation. Let's go and find it. When I try to summarize or to think of how lucky we were along the way, this was our greatest luck, because for 7 or 8 years, nobody believed us that we are working on any biologically relevant system. Whenever I came to a meeting, people say, yeah, keep on working on the red cell. It has nothing to do with the real biology. So it's kind of a terminally differentiating cell, and people thought, well, this is, it may be right, but it's very limited in scope. So we published the first paper in BBRC in 78. Now people laugh at it. What is BBRC? Nobody can get promoted, you know, the whole culture of bibliometric. I will not go into it, but by far this was the most important paper we ever published. I agree with Avram about it. It's also cited more than several thousand times. But why was it a paradigm shift? Already in the first paper, it was a paradigm shift. It was a paradigm shift typically In the proteolytic world, you are dancing a tango of two, the classical tango. There is a protease and a substrate. Take trypsin. Trypsin will digest any protein that has either arginine or lysine, right? It will cleave the C-terminal lysine or arginine. Take chymotrypsin. It will digest any protein that has an aromatic amino acid, phenylalanine or tyrosine. And, you know, once you are above certain size of a protein, 100 amino acids or 50 amino acids, you will get these amino acids presented. So typically, proteases dance a tango of two. Here already, at the very beginning, we took the reticulocyte lysate and we fractionated it on an anion exchange column, and some of the protein adsorbed to the resin, some of the protein broke through, they didn't adsorb. We call those that didn't adsorb fraction one, those that did adsorb fraction two. And you see already that in the crude lysate, just you take a lysate, you take cells and you blow them out with water. You osmotically disrupt them and you spin down the membrane. In the high-speed supernatant, you have already what we wanted. We had ATP-dependent proteolytic activity. So that's what we wanted. It's non-lysosomal. There are no lysosomes, so it cannot be lysosomal. It was also at pH 8, so another safety measure. But then once we put the lysate on a column, we lost the activity. The non-adsorbed protein and the adsorbed protein didn't have the activity by themselves, little activity on the adsorbed protein, but once we combined them, we got it back. So this is a tango of three. You need fraction one, fraction two, and the substrate. So you say, what's the difference? Two, three, big deal. It's a very big deal. It's a big deal because fraction one and fraction two represent half of the cellular proteins. It's the separation is by virtue of the characteristics of the column. It's an anion exchange resin. So 10,000 proteins are in fraction one and 10,000 proteins are in fraction two. So who told us that fraction one has only one active ingredient? Maybe it has one A and one B, and if we take them apart, we shall lose the activity again. And the same for fraction two, and then you take one N and further and further and further. I will not tire you. We pulled our sleeves, went into the cold room, and started to fractionate and fractionate and fractionate the column. At the very end, again, extreme luck. I cannot explain you the luck because I don't understand it myself. We found about 14 fractions, 1-4, that are all needed in order to be in the test tube together in order to degrade the protein. But the 14 is meaningless because what do they do? So then we took them one by one, and with wonderful biochemistry, we found what they are doing. So we were able to build a cascade of events. So we were able to go from A to B to C to D. It took a long biochemistry work, many years, but we reconstituted the system. This was only the beginning of the story. I'll jump with you directly to April 2000. And what happened in April 2000 is the human genome. And the human genome revealed to us that the system that we discovered, that I'll show you the principles in a minute, contained close to 2,000 proteins, not 14. There was no way that biochemistry could have ever discovered those proteins, but we were lucky enough to get the principal protein all out, because we could lock ourselves easily in a corner and get 20 that are belonging to some niche in the system, and then we could never really unravel the system. Because the system is built of subfamilies and many different activities, each contain hundreds of proteins, so we managed to pull out by biochemistry representative of each of the major functional groups. This is, I mean, I cannot define it but a luck, sheer luck. But anyway, the system is huge. It's the biggest family in the database, much bigger than the number of proteins that are required to synthesize proteins, but it's nothing to compare because the synthesis of proteins is based on an information that is embedded in nucleic acid. Here it's all embedded in protein-protein interaction. So it's a different ballgame. It's nothing to compare at all. But 2,000 proteins are involved. And I'll show you just the principles. And the principles is the following. We have a substrate, a protein, that needs to be degraded. And again, remember two principles. One is the principle of protection from the proteolytic activity. And the second, which I mentioned in passing, is the principle of specificity. I told you that only misfolded protein will be degraded and not folded. So if something happens to a protein, the system has to recognize one molecule out of 1,000 that are healthy and take them. Cyclins, it has to be timed and programmed. So the system must be equipped with a high degree of specificity. In this case, the protein to be degraded has to be phosphorylated. It's just one example that I bring. It's not always. Many proteins have to be phosphorylated in order to be degraded, but some, many not, so it's just one example. The protein is being scaffolded to a protein called ubiquitin ligase, or a ligator of ubiquitin. You'll understand the name in a minute. In parallel, a small molecule called ubiquitin, it's a 76 amino acid residue small molecule, is being activated by an enzyme called E1. There is a single E1 in the database. This mechanism requires ATP, its activation of the C-terminus, exactly like amino acids are being activated to protein synthesis. We deciphered it at the molecular level. From E1, it goes to E2, the activated ubiquitin, the energy is maintained. There are about 50 E2s in the database. And from E2, it's going to the substrate. So it's going to the substrate and marks it. So it's a covalent conjugation. It's a post-translational modification, much like phosphorylation, but much more complicated than phosphorylation, that the protein is conjugated to the substrate. The second ubiquitin is conjugated to the first, the third to the second, and so on and so forth. So we are building a polyubiquitin chain that serves as a proteolytic recognition signal. To whom? To which? To a downstream protease. And the downstream protease is called the 26S protease. Now at last come the scissors that cuts the protein. And the protease is called the 26S proteasome. It's a 2 million Dalton protease that is made of close to 40 subunits. It has a regulatory complex at the end, and it has a proteolytic complex in the middle. The real scissors are sitting here on the two inner rings. They are called the beta rings. And it's a huge protease. The three-dimensional structure was deciphered by a group of structural biologists initially at the Max Planck Institute in Martinsried near Munich. And the protein, the ubiquitin, binds to the protease and brings the substrate close. Something... Oh. Okay. The protein gets unfolded. You see this thread. Something went wrong in the presentation. So the protein unfolds and injected into the protease, and peptides are coming out. The little pieces that came out are the peptides. So the protein is not degraded to amino acids, but to peptides. Now, let's go to the principle of protection. Only ubiquitinated proteins are degraded. So by that mechanism, the cell could have afforded to itself to have a protease, which is a shark, floating freely in the cytosol without having any problem, because the protease is harmless protease. It will not touch any protein unless the protein is ubiquitinated. So the secret of the system is not the protease. The secret is the specificity of ubiquitination. Only proteins that are ubiquitinated will be eaten, chewed down by the protease. Proteins that are not ubiquitinated can swim side by side by this shark, and the shark will not recognize them. This is the secret of specificity. Now, ubiquitination is carried out by the E3, by the ubiquitin ligase, and there are about 1,000 of them. So out of the 2,000 components of the ubiquitin system, 1,000 are ubiquitin ligases that recognize specifically oxidized, methylated, unfolded, any type of proteins that needs to be degraded. There is a repertoire of ubiquitin ligases that will recognize it and will ubiquitinate it and render it susceptible to the activity of the protease. So you see how nature evolved a very sophisticated mechanism. You can argue, okay, there is an alternative mechanism, but it didn't occur. If the lysosome would have evolved 2,000 different receptors for 2,000 recognition motifs on denatured, misfolded, or timed out proteins. This is another mechanism. So only proteins that need to be degraded will bind to the receptor and will cross the membrane of the lysosome. This is an alternative mechanism. But numerically, we don't save anything. So, and you'll see that the ubiquitin system went well beyond proteolysis. It's not proteolysis, it's only one of its functions. Okay, the system became very complicated. I will not... the binding of one ubiquitin to the other in order to be recognized by the proteasome is occurring via internal lysines. So, and typically for degradation is internal lysine 48. Gradually people discover that ubiquitin has 7 lysine and each of them can be ubiquitinated. And each ubiquitination of a different lysine sends the ubiquitinated proteins that has a different chain to a different destination. So you see that gradually, and I'll show you, we evolved here, or nature evolved here, a whole language. And the language talks not only to proteolytic system, or to the proteases, but to many other cellular processes. So the basic mechanism is the following. Here is the substrate, it has a lysine, the lysine has an amino group, and ubiquitin is bound via its C-terminus. Now lysine 48, which is one of the 7 lysines, is ubiquitinated further, and then lysine 48 of the second one is ubiquitinated, and so on and forth, so forth. This is the chain that I showed you. But remember that ubiquitin has 7 lysines, and each of them can be ubiquitinated, and each of them will send the substrate to a different destination. So this one will send the substrate to the proteasome. The proteasome can recognize only what we call lysine 48-based polyubiquitin chain, and we know now the structural secret of it. But if the chain will be bound to lysine 63, or to lysine 11, or to lysine 6, or to lysine 33, the same very protein will be sent somewhere else. And without going into details, the language of ubiquitination became very complex. Not only that the language became very complex, but ubiquitin has not remained a single member of its family, and many members were discovered. One of them is sumo. Sumo is not this thin, diet-rich Japanese. Now there are no Japanese warriors anymore. They are mostly coming from Mongolia. If you go even to Japanese sumo battles, you will see that the dominant sumo warriors are Mongolian. Here is sumo. Sumo is not this Japanese, as I said, it's small ubiquitin modifier. So it's an homolog of ubiquitin, and there is a whole family of them. And you see it's longer, but the overlay shows that a very highly similar structural characteristics. And sumo also, with its C-terminus, modifies protein for completely different purposes. And if you go to the whole family, you'll see a huge family of ubiquitin-like protein. So the language broadened enormously, not only within ubiquitin, with the different chains, but also with different proteins. And gradually, proteolysis remained a side issue of the ubiquitin system. The reason that we discovered the ubiquitin system was because we were not screening. We came from bottom to the top. We asked the biological question. We didn't mean to discover the ubiquitin system. We didn't have any notion to discover any system. We asked a biological question and we wanted to know the answer, and the ubiquitin system unveiled itself. But then gradually it turned out that this is only one function of the ubiquitin system, and like phosphorylation, it serves numerous functions. And by the way, the similarity to phosphorylation is striking. You know, we have E1 and E2 and E3 for ubiquitination. We have 600 kinases for phosphorylation. Then we have deubiquitinating enzymes that recycle ubiquitin. We have phosphatases. And at the very end, phosphate and ubiquitin serve the same very purpose. They are recognition by various, they are recognized by various downstream elements. If it's lysine 48, they will, the proteasome. It's, if it will be a different chain, it will be another ubiquitin recognizing element. And then the binding serves for signaling output. In the case of proteolysis, it will be degradation. The same for phosphorylation. Think about the EGF receptor. You engage the ligand, you phosphorylate the receptor, the phosphate tail will bind the eject protein, and the eject protein will elicit phosphorylation of another protein to start a signaling cascade. So the same very principle. So both ubiquitin and phosphate are basically binding elements to downstream proteins to initiate a downstream process. One case is proteolysis. So, and the same is true for phosphorylation. And by the way, the two systems talk to one another, as I showed you in one example, that the protein has to be phosphorylated in order to get ubiquitinated. So there is a real conversation, an intense conversation between the two pathways. But if you think evolutionarily, the similarities are striking. Let's go to the very last few minutes to medicine. And needless to say that a system of 2,000 components immediately found its target diseases, aberrations in the system. A whole textbook can be written on ubiquitin-related diseases. I will not go into it, but you can imagine, again, why the principle. Proteins are degraded and they are at a steady state. If a protein is excessively degraded, it will go below its steady state. If a protein is under-degraded, it will rise above its steady state. And without going into too many examples, we shall just focus, in order to leave time for questions, on cancer. If you think about tumor suppressors, like P53, if P53 will be excessively degraded by the ubiquitin system, then the cell will be depleted of a tumor suppressor and will be exposed to malignancy. And the opposite. If an oncogenic protein or a growth-promoting protein like beta-catenin or the EGF receptor will be under-degraded, the same will happen. We shall drive the cell towards oncogenic transformation. Now, all these cases do occur. Think about tumor suppressor, P53 over-degradation. Take one of the most common cancers, HPV, human papilloma virus-induced uterine cervical carcinoma. The virus that sits in the epithelium of the uterine cervix encodes an early oncogen called E6. E6 heterodimerizes to P53. The ubiquitin system looks at it and finds an abnormal protein, it never seen it, and degrades P53. This is purposeful evolutionary event by the virus, because the virus, before integrating its DNA into the cellular DNA that would otherwise elicit the P53 quality control checkpoint pathway, the virus eliminates P53. There is no P53. And only then, by the late gene, the integration event can occur. And once the integration event can occur, it can go on because there will be no P53. And here you can see an example of a malignant transformation occurring because of a removal of a tumor suppressor, and the opposite here. Think about Herceptin-sensitive breast cancer, where the EGF receptor is truncated and signals to the cell all the time, instead of binding the ligand, getting ubiquitinated and being eliminated by the vacuolar lysosomal system. So the EGF receptor sits on the cell surface and signals non-stop to the cell, because it doesn't need, it cannot bind the ligand, and it doesn't need ligand engagement in order to signal to the cell. So you see that on both cases, you can have malignant transformation. I will show you just two drugs. One is already in the market, very successful one, and other one just to give you an idea of where we head. So the first drug that is on the market is already 10 years. Actually, we are already third generation into it. And it's a drug to multiple myeloma. Multiple myeloma is a B-cell leukemia. It's a disease in which there is monoclonal expansion in the bone marrow of B-cells. Actually, it's one cell. And B-cells are IgG secretory cells. So instead of, you know, Patrick was talking about micro-sequencing, including development of sensitive proteomics, in order to identify biomarkers for malignancy. In this case, you don't need to develop anything because the patient is drowning in an ocean of a biomarker. The IgG level, the specific IgG level, rises to 1-2 grams per deciliter. It's huge. Basically, I think that you can hold the tube and see it. And I'll explain in a minute what's going on and touch a little bit on personalized medicine. So the first drug was developed to multiple myeloma. The disease is when I was a medical student, it was a deadly disease within 2 years. Now, the whole landscape of the disease changed dramatically. Patients are living with high quality of life for 5, 6, 8 years. So what happened, the B cells occupy the space of the bone marrow and suppress all other elements, red blood cells, white blood cells, platelets. The patient is suffering typically from pathological fracture. They come with a fracture in the vertebra or in the long bone. So basically, they're coming with a backache. This will be a typical complaint. They cannot breathe because they don't have red blood cells. They are suffering from infections, no white blood cells, bleeding, no platelets. They are suffering from kidney problems because the high levels of IgG secreted blocks the tubuli of the glomeruli. So it's a multi-symptom, very bad disease. And this is an inhibitor of the proteasome. You see here the active sites of the proteasome here. And this is the drug itself. It's called bortezomib. It's a tripeptide. And there is a boronic acid here that electrophilically attacks the threonine in the active site. I will just show you a patient just to give you an idea. Here is the galloping level of the IgA. You see it, the biomarker. Chemotherapy started, the patient responds partially, and then the disease relapses, and then once bortezomib or Velcade is given to the patient, there is a nice response, and almost elimination of the whole marker. And if you look at the bone marrow, you can see that from a malignant homogeneous bone marrow with more than 40% malignant cells, the bone marrow is kind of rejuvenated with less than 1% of cells, and the rejuvenation is with the normal progenitors of all the families of the blood cells. You can see here, as I told you, you can see the distinct bend in electrophoresis of the antibody, and after treatment you can see the fuzzy bending of the population, of the different population of the antibodies that we are all equipped with. And here you can see a cousin disease, which is non-Hodgkin lymphoma, and you can see here the tumor sitting in the hilum of the right lung and following one cycle of treatment and monomodal treatment, single therapy treatment. Now the patients are being treated via a multi-drug approach. The tumor shrunk significantly. Now, the mechanism of action here, it's not a chemotherapy. It's eliciting the unfolded protein response in the ER. And by eliciting the unfolding protein response, it's apoptosis the cell. It leads to apoptosis of the cell. Normally, these IgGs are secretory proteins, and many of them are secreted. I mean, all of them are secreted, and in multiple myeloma, even more. Some of them, like the normal mechanism, are misfolded in the ER, but the misfolded proteins are not secreted. But they are retrotranslocated, you see here, and degraded by the proteasome, by the ubiquitin system. If we inhibit the proteasome, even partially, the misfolded proteins are accumulated in the ER and elicit the unfolded protein response, which kills the cell. So it's not a chemotherapy. It doesn't have the side effects of chemotherapy. It has its own problems, its own side effects, which is mostly a peripheral neuropathy, but I will not talk into it. So you see that the drug to cancer came from a completely unexpected side, and I think that I shall end up here because time is limiting, and I will just... you see, there are many diseases. Actually, the pipeline of the companies is full of drugs. I mean, all the big companies are in there. And obviously, just one word on multiple myeloma. Not all patients respond so nicely, so we need to sort out the responders for the non-responders, and here personalized medicine comes in, and we already have some very good markers in the unfolded protein response pathway that we can pull out patients with high accuracy that will respond favorably to the drug versus those that will not respond. But it's all molecular diagnostics, as we all know. And as I said, the initial work was done when I was a graduate student with Avram. Then I went to MIT to a postdoc and at Harvey Lodish's lab, but I collaborated at the same time with Alex Warshavsky and Dan Finley in a different lab. We took the system further to some other discoveries and then many graduate students and postdocs along the years. So I hope that I gave you a little bit of a flavor of how just curiosity, because we were driven an open question in biology, at the end, without even an intention of the discoverer, lead to very heavy translation of the discovery into drugs. So thank you very much.